Sri Lanka is faced with the worst import controls since the 1970s. So how does this impact trade? Because isn't trade important? And isn't it crucial for any country? Or does it mean that we can be, as a nation, self-sufficient to a great extent?
I think trade is crucial if we're going to see economic growth. We're not going to see economic growth if we take trade out of the equation. And yes, the import controls definitely had an impact on the economy. I think Sri Lanka, we like to talk a lot about how we are at the center of the Indian Ocean. We are a maritime hub at the crossroads of all of these trade routes, and all of that is true. And simply because that is true is why we need to be trading.
Welcome everyone. It's been a while since my last conversation. However, I do hope you're keeping safe. Today, I'm back with a new conversation, and the focus of discussion in this episode will be the state of the Sri Lankan economy. Where exactly does the Sri Lankan economy stand? And where did it stand before the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic? Today, I will be in conversation with the research manager of the Advocata Institute, Anita Varusavitharana. The Advocata is an independent policy think tank based in Colombo. Welcome, and thank you for being a part of this conversation.
Thank you, Alanki, for having me here. I'm very excited to be here.
Well, to start things off, Anita, I would like to know, there has been much focus on the economy of Sri Lanka. There is no doubt that the economy of Sri Lanka has been hit hard by the pandemic. However, I'd like to know first, if Sri Lanka was headed towards a recession even before the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic?
So I maybe wouldn't use the word recession in describing the economic situation prior to the pandemic. Also because it'll be difficult to kind of separate those two instances, the pandemic and our economic situation coming into it. However, it is very clear that Sri Lanka's economy was already vulnerable in the months in the lead up to the pandemic. A key reason for this vulnerability is our debt situation. So Sri Lanka's debt obligations in 2019 were about 14 trillion rupees, according to the Ministry of Finance. And of course, we can't forget that in 2019, we also had the Easter Sunday terror attacks, which had an immense human toll. And in addition to that, also had a fairly significant economic fallback. So I would say that these factors definitely contributed to a weaker economic situation in the lead up to the pandemic in 2020.
Also, the SLPP-led government provided very generous tax concessions in early 2020. Do you really think this helped the economy to grow, or do you think it impacted it in a negative manner?
So, Alanki, I mean, hindsight is 2020, and now when we know that Sri Lanka has been affected very badly by this pandemic, the tax cuts may seem to be, can be viewed in a different light, I would say. But at the point when the government introduced these concessions, the rationale that they presented was that, you know, 2019 had already been a difficult year. Mm-hmm. As I mentioned earlier, we had the Easter Sunday attacks, and that had a fairly significant effect on our economy. So the tax cuts were presented as a sort of relief for businesses,
right,
and was intended to act as a stimulus on the economy. However, now that we see the pandemic and we know what we're in for, we know it's not going to be an easy couple of months or even a year coming forward. And given that rising expenditures mean that we do need revenue to fund this, these concessions could be looked at with a critical eye, I would say. But what I would like to focus on is not just simply the concessions, because the problem with Sri Lanka's tax system is that we have a ratio of direct to indirect taxes, mm-hmm, that's skewed very heavily towards indirect taxes. And what that means is that your average Sri Lankan is contributing far more to the tax revenue of the government, to put it very simply, because this means that the government is raising its revenue mainly from things like taxes at the border, so taxes on imports of the day-to-day things that people purchase, and also on VAT, which is also a tax on your day-to-day purchases, day-to-day consumption.
So that would amount to an indirect tax.
That would be an indirect tax, exactly. And our direct tax components, which would be something like income tax, for instance, contribute a far smaller proportion to our revenue collection. And when you look at Sri Lanka's income tax rates, our rates are actually very reasonable, I would say. They're not too harsh. We have a very large bracket of income that you don't get taxed under. And then each tax band comes into play. And one this ties into another issue that we see with our tax system, which is that we don't have a large base of taxation. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of Sri Lankans don't have tax files, essentially. And this means that you're taxing only a small percentage of your population.
Right, absolutely.
Direct taxing in the form of direct taxation. So just simply widening the tax base, so you basically tax more people, but you can keep rates a little bit more reasonable. So keeping in mind that this is a difficult year, you know, you don't need to raise taxes, to very high levels. But that would improve our tax collection while at the least amount of discomfort to the average Sri Lankan. And removal through these tax concessions, removal of things like the payee, removal of the withholding tax, meant that you have fewer direct taxes being collected, which is unfortunate. So I would say that those are some things that we would maybe want to kind of think about in the months to come, and especially post-budget, when it comes to how Sri Lanka raises revenue in the years to come.
How well do you think the budget 2021 has dealt with this issue?
There are a few interesting points that have come out from the budget. One thing that the government has committed to is a kind of simplified and uniform taxation system in the country, which is definitely a positive, because when you have kind of consistency in taxation, that helps businesses, it helps investment. Mm-hmm. But the fact that we didn't see some of these things being reversed could maybe be something we can think about, I would say. The government did have a lot of political capital. It could have been possible for it to reverse some of this in light of the pandemic, possibly to raise revenue. I would say that's where we are.
And also, I'd like to know, how well has the budget 2021 dealt with those who have been faced with numerous challenges due to the pandemic, such as those with small businesses and those who have lost their livelihoods due to the pandemic?
Sure. So one of the measures that have been brought in the budget is a concessional loan scheme for small businesses. Mm-hmm. And one would assume that it has been introduced in light of the pandemic to help these businesses kind of get their footing, start up again. Because businesses have been hit very hard.
Right.
The Department of Labor did an e-survey in May that looked at, and out of the businesses surveyed, around 50% said that they were temporarily pausing their operations. But people remain optimistic. That survey showed that 97% of businesses that they interviewed in that survey expected to reopen. They had a positive outlook. So, I mean, we can remain optimistic, I would say.
So they did not hope to close permanently.
So little over 50% had closed during that period of the survey, and 44% were working under capacity. So they were kind of limiting their operations a little. And this was a survey that they did in May, if I'm not mistaken. So things would have changed by now. But that kind of gives you an idea of, it gives an indication of how businesses are, kind of how hard businesses have been hit during the pandemic.
But do you think the budget has provided any sort of relief or hope?
Well, I mean, this loan scheme is definitely a measure that, mm-hmm. that will help businesses to a certain extent. And then we've also seen the central bank extend the loan moratorium that was issued earlier. And it has been extended from, I believe, October for another 6 months. So
okay.
That will also help businesses at this point.
Right. Yes. I'd also like to bring your attention to the import controls. Sri Lanka is faced with the worst import controls since the 1970s. So how does this impact trade? Because isn't trade important, and isn't it crucial for any country? Or does it mean that we can be, as a nation, self-sufficient to a great extent?
So I think that's a great question. I think trade is crucial if we're going to see economic growth. We're not going to see economic growth if we take trade out of the equation. And yes, the import controls definitely had an impact on our the economy. The rationale behind that at the point of imposing it was to kind of protect our reserves, the currency, etc. But it definitely had a negative impact on the economy. It would have affected supply chains, affected local businesses. And now we've seen a relaxation of these import restrictions for the most part. And to tackle the second part of your question on whether, you know, we're going to see whether self-sufficiency is the way to go. I think Sri Lanka, we like to talk a lot about how we are at the center of the Indian Ocean. We are a maritime hub at the crossroads of all of these trade routes. And all of that is true. And simply because that is true is why we need to be trading. We need to exploit that location.
Because we are at the center of it all.
For sure. But also right. on like just... how, like, the equation for growth, even if we weren't at the center of the Indian Ocean, the equation for growth would have trade in it. Self-sufficiency is I feel like when people say self-sufficiency, there's a definite positive connotation to it, right? There's a sense of security
Absolutely.
That comes with that word. But I think what people also kind of need to understand is that you can have that security with a strong trading system. If you're a strong trading nation and you have kind of diversified your supply chains, you will still be safe. I think, if you look at, for example, food security, Singapore is one of the most food secure nations in the world, and it doesn't grow its food in its country. It gets it in. So I think that especially right now, you know, we can't be sort of separate from the rest of the world. We are inherently interconnected. And when you look at the nature of trade in the world, over 70% of trade, according to the OECD, happens through global value chains. So what Sri Lanka needs to do is insert itself into those chains and capitalize on the benefits that they bring so that we can create a sense of security. So we have a strong economic system with strong fundamentals that will then provide a safety net for our people.
But the argument they put forward is that it promotes local industry.
I think once again, the two are not separate to each other. You will still, the local industries will probably have a better shot at surviving and thriving and competing if we were to integrate into the global economy in a competitive manner.
And what you're saying is both could really coexist.
100%. And not only coexist, but grow from one another.
Absolutely.
And our local industries will have far more opportunity if we were to integrate with the rest of the world.
Okay, we've come to the last question, but it's a very important question. Let's talk about the much talked about tax on sanitary pads. Why isn't this considered an essential item? And do you think the tax should be removed?
I mean, 100%, I think the tax should be removed. And importantly, the tax needs to be removed not only on the final product that is imported into the country, which is currently at around 52%, we also need to remove the tax on inputs into production. Because I cannot stress this enough, this conversation on sanitary napkins is not a question of where it is produced, because that is not the thing of priority here. What is of priority is the fact that this is essential for all the women and girls in this country. 52% of your population, around 5 million menstruating women, they need this. It is not an option. And because of that, I think the focus of the debate needs to shift to this fact and not to this question of local production. But I think it's also important to make the distinction that because we do have local manufacturers, and that's great, we need to remove the tax on inputs into production as well. Because they're producing an essential product for this country, we need to remove it. And then on a second level, because this is an essential product and because something like menstruation is so inherently different from woman to woman, you need to have choice. You need to be able to choose a product that suits you. And especially right now, when you have such a variety of products in the world, in the global market, effort. It is a shame that women in Sri Lanka don't have that choice, that a girl who wants to do high jump or run, play, take part in her swimming meet, or just wants to be able to focus during maths class, can't find a product that suits her requirement. Mm-hmm. And as much as for girls, but also for women, for mothers, for business women, for people who just want to have peace of mind during their period. And I think that is just absolutely essential. And we're not going to have that if we have these tariffs. And I would like to make one final point on that, Alanki, because this is something I feel very strongly about. We know that these taxes aren't raising a lot of revenue for the government. So that can't be the rationale for these taxes to be in place, right? I mean, where you put in a tax generally to raise revenue, or you put in a tax to like disincentivize consumption, right, like a sin tax on cigarettes, etc. I'm assuming the government doesn't think sanitary napkins are a sin and that that's not the motive for taxation here. So then that leaves us with one option, that these taxes are put in place as a protectionist measure. And by that I mean is that local manufacturers do benefit from this tax being in place because they are able to then keep higher margins, and they are able to, their product is able to be priced better than the imported product that comes in, right? And the problem here is, apart from the fact that those are economic rents and that's an uncompetitive market, the problem here is that you're doing this at the cost of the women and girls in this country. And I think given that this government has also committed, has made some very strong, very commendable commitments to improving the quality of life of women and girls, I think this is 100% in their agenda, it is in their priority, and we can hope that we will see reform here and we will see these taxes coming down, not only on the final product, but also on the inputs into production.
Let's really hope that our lawmakers actually consider this and actually bring about a positive change that would actually impact the majority of women living in Sri Lanka. Thank you so much for your time. This was indeed a very fruitful conversation. Thank you for watching. I will be back with another episode. Until then, do stay safe and take care.